Perek Tet is an interesting perek. Until Mishnah Hey, for Mishnah Aleph, Bet, Gimel, and Dalet, the next four Mishnahs is not going to be discussing Shabbat at all. We're not going to discuss Shabbat, it's going to go off on a tangent. And the reason why it goes off on a tangent, we just brought from Yeshaya a verse that was in Asmachta, that was a support to our things. So since we went off the way and we discussed in Asmachta, now he's going to give us examples of other Asmachtas, examples of other verses that people use as a support for a law. Remember, it only is a support, it's not a proof. If you have a good logic, or if you heard it from Moshe Rabbeinu, or if there's a discussion, did Moshe Rabbeinu says this or that, two schools, one school says, we heard that Moshe Rabbeinu came from the mountain and said that, and the other school says, we heard Moshe Rabbeinu came down and said that. Now you can bring that as a support to you or not. But it's, or you have a good logic, and the other guy also has a good logic, you can bring support for that. But it's only support. It doesn't have the power of a proof. So since we already discussed in Yeshaya one kind of support, it goes off a tangent and uses all the support you can find in that chapter in Yeshaya. I think they all come from Yeshaya, but we'll see soon. Bi'ur Mishnah Aleph. So we are Perek Tet Mishnah Aleph. Agav siyuma shel Mishnah Kodemet, because of the ending of the previous Mishnah, Sodru berosh pirkenu our Mishnayot. In the head of our chapter, there's four Mishnas. Shetochnan kubatz ma'amarim shonim, shekulam matchil b'sheela. That their main point is that they all start with the question, minayin, from where? From where do we know? Umavi'im ra'ayot min mikraot b'derech asmachta. And then we bring proofs from the verses in a way of asmachta. Remember, asmachta is just support. Hainu she'enam ra'ayot mamash, ela zecher ledavar. They're not really proofs. They're just helping. They're just a hint. They're just whatever you want to call it. Mishnatenu shnuya b'masechet avodah zara. So we're going to have four mishnayot. The first mishnah is going to be in the tractate of idol worship. Shamu va'ot tchilat da tanakama. Over there it brought in the beginning the opinion of the first Tana. She'im neheras kotel shel beit avodah zara. That if a wall of a church, of a house of idol worship was destroyed, avana ve'etza ve'afaro metam'im kesheretz. All the stones and the wood and everything else from that building, if you touch it, they give a person becomes defiled, just like he touched a dead frog or a dead lizard, like he touched the sheretz. Hainu b'maga. It means you, if you touch those stones, you become defiled, you need to go to the mikveh. Before you eat truma or other, you go to the Beis HaMikdash and other things. Aval lo b'masa. But if you carry them, you don't touch them directly. You carry them or you move them with another object. Aval lo b'masa. Ve'ilu Rabbi Akiva. But Rabbi Akiva saying, you are also, if you carry them, you become defiled. Not just if you touch them directly. In other words, if there's a blanket and they're on top of the blanket and you move the blanket and that be moved, you're also obligated, according to Rabbi Akiva, and that's what we're going to be discussing now.
Okay. We're talking about carrying without touching.
Carrying without touching, that's right. And we're not going to deal with it right now when we're going to come to Tuma and Tara, to purity and impurity. We're going to really deal with these things when we get to Buddha. Amar Rabbi Akiva said, Minayin la'avodah zara shemetama b'masa. So Rabbi Akiva, he's the one that says that idol worship, if you carry it, you also becomes defiled. You also become impure. All the other people says, no, only if you touch it, you become impure. So now, and it looks like the other logic is stronger than Rabbi Akiva's, because it looks like the verses themselves, it says if you touch, you become defiled, not if you carry. So now Rabbi Akiva has to bring us, if he wants to continue with his line of thinking, he has to give us a proof. Why does he think that in his opinion, also carrying? Where do you find it? There's no verses. So where do you get it from? Sha'anoseh ota tameh, that Rabbi Akiva says that if you carry an idol worship, you become impure. Afilu lo nagaba kshenasa, even if he didn't touch it directly when he carried it. He says, I'm learning it from a nida, from a menstruating woman. I'm learning it. He says, what do you mean? Kedin nida. It says, it's just like a menstruating woman, that if you touch her, you become impure. It's the same thing. So he says, what do you mean it's the same thing? He says, I have a verse. Again, the verse is an asmachta, it's not a proof. Sheneemar b'inyan avodat zara. It says, when it comes to idol worship, tizarem kmo dava. It says you should scatter them, you should break them and scatter the remainders of the idol worship. Kmo dava, like a woman who's menstruating, a woman who's impure. Tse vetomar lo, it says go and learn from this verse. Vedoresh mikan Rabbi Akiva, Rabbi Akiva. And again, this verse comes from Yeshaya, from the same chapter we learned last time. Vedoresh mikan Rabbi Akiva, and from here Rabbi Akiva learns Shavoda Zara, that I'm learning from this verse that idol worship doma liinyan tum'a lenida. It is similar when it comes to impurity to a woman who is impure. Ma nida metama b'masa, just like a nida. If you carry a nida, you don't touch her directly, you become impure. Sheneemar ba, it says, how do you know by a nida that you become impure? Maybe it's only touching by a nida. Because in Vayikra it says, v'chol anogea b'chol kli, it says, and anybody who touches any vessel, asher teshev alav, that she set upon, yechabes b'gadav v'rachatz b'mayim v'tameh. He should wash his clothes, and he washed in water, went to the mikveh, and v'tameh adarev, he's going to become impure until evening. This is one of the severe things that we discussed, if you remember a couple of days ago, with what the handicap goes out, and it says anything the handicap sits on, if it's a seat, he becomes very impure, not just regular impure like clothing. Clothing is not very impure, but this, because you sit on it or you lay on it, becomes very impure. So we hear the nida set on something, so that thing became very impure. Umikan shehi metama et hakli shenasa ota. And from here we learn that she defiles the vessel that carried her. Af al pi shelo nagaba, even though it did not touch her. Sheafilu ayu asara kelim ze al ze, even if there were 10 vessels, one on top of another, kulam asher b'chal teshev alav. I don't care if she sits on the top, she sits on all of them. So if you carry it, you're carrying her. Yeah, it transfers. Af avoda zara metma b'masa. So Rabbi Akiva says, I'm learning of it from over here that even idol worship is going to become defiled in carrying. Usually the halacha is not like Rabbi Akiva, like we already know. Klomar gam b'masa, ve'en halacha k'Rabbi Akiva. And the halacha is not like Rabbi Akiva. This is, let's just discuss it a little bit, we discussed it before, but just to make a repetition for this, a chazara, it says it's very strange, if you think about it, Rabbi Akiva's time, he was the grand teacher. Right, Rabbi Akiva. Most of the other sages that lived in his time were his students. So it says, what do you mean? If your teacher is teaching you something, how can the halacha not be like Rabbi Akiva? So from here we learn a very important rule by halacha, and very important rule by God also. In other words, what's the rule? The rule is reality, the way you understand thing, is halacha. It's not the way you know it is, or you believe it is. It's the way you see it. So let's see, let's discuss this. So when Rabbi Akiva tells the student something, if you ask the student, who is right, you, Rabbi Akiva, the student is going to laugh at you. He says, what do you mean? He understands a million times more than me. We can't even think. But there's a problem. When we're supposed to say the halacha, we're supposed to say the law, we're supposed to say the way we understand it. And we don't understand it his way. We understand it our way better then we understand it his way. He's a spiritual man. He looks at the world in a different manner. The reality of the world is halacha. It's not the theoretical world. He lives in a theoretical world. He can stay there in the spiritual world, but it's not reality. Our reality is different than his reality. He sees the world differently. He lives in the times of Mashiach already. He sees good in bad. We don't see good in bad. We cannot pasken that this is good. In other words, when Rabbi Akiva, somebody broke his leg, right? So the says, what's the bracha you should say? You should say the bracha on something bad happening or something good happening? So everybody is saying, of course, something bad happened. Rabbi Akiva sees, it's a good thing. Whatever he sees. It's the same thing we have if you remember, they were walking and they saw the destruction of the temple. And Rabbi Akiva was laughing and everybody else was crying. He says, he saw Mashiach. They see destruction. So he says, the halacha is what we see, what we understand, not what righteous people understand. So that's why halacha is almost never like Rabbi Akiva.